Welcome to the 1600 Sessions. I'm Stewart McLaurin, President of the White House Historical Association. 2022 is just beginning, and many of you may have rung in the new year by singing Auld Lang Syne with friends and with loved ones as the clock struck midnight on New Year's Eve. But did you know that wee poem has a place in White House history? Famed Scottish poet Robert Burns, who authored Auld Lang Syne in the late 18th century, was one of Abraham Lincoln's greatest literary and personal inspirations. In fact, it's said that Lincoln actually kept a copy of Burns' poems on his bedside table in the White House. In this episode, I'll talk with us today from his home in Stirling, and Mr. Ian Houston, who will be with me here in the studio, who's president of the Scottish Business Network Americas. So perhaps we should start at the beginning of this story with Abraham Lincoln's actual introduction to Robert Burns' work and his published volumes. So although Lincoln was born over a decade after Burns' death, and it was obviously thousands of miles away from Scotland, he was introduced to Burns' book at a very young age. Murray, share this story about how Lincoln came to be exposed to a poet from Scotland.
It's pretty likely that Burns' songs were being sung in the Ohio Valley when Lincoln was there in the 1820s, and that he had some acquaintance with the poet earlier. The interesting thing is that they shared so much, the families shared so much, because not only did Lincoln's father, Thomas, have similar problems over entitlement to land ownership as Burns' father had, but also when the farm in Indiana that Thomas Lincoln had from 1827 was almost exactly the same size as the farm at Mount Oliphant, where Burns grew up. And also Burns's poetry and song was being used by the abolitionist movement as early as the 1820s, certainly, particularly A Man's a Man. So it's quite likely that Lincoln had an acquaintance from it there too. But the contact with Jack Kelso was the only certain one we have. It's just likely that it came from elsewhere.
And who was Jack Kelso?
There's much more rumored about than actually known. He was at different times a teacher. He was reputed to have had a large private library. Some people say he was born in Scotland, some that he was of Scottish extraction. But what we know for certain is that he shared a house with a man called James Cameron, near Lincoln in the early 1830s, and that he was an enthusiast for Burns and Shakespeare, and transmitted that enthusiasm in both cases to President Lincoln.
It really shows how significant an influence that teachers can have on young minds like Abraham Lincoln. Ian, there are some parallels, actually, between Burns and Lincoln's upbringings. Can you speak to those similarities and how they may have deepened young Abraham Lincoln's connection to Burns' works in those early formative years of Lincoln's life?
They're quite extraordinary, and I think they were very motivational to a young Abraham Lincoln. Being born in the circumstances that he was born in Kentucky in 1809, we all know the story of Lincoln and his upbringing, very modest circumstances, and a log cabin home, a one-room log cabin home in Kentucky. He had very little in terms of formal education. He had a great wealth of spirit, though. I think the poverty that we speak of is financial poverty. The spirit of Lincoln was a wealthy young spirit. And the same was the case with Robert Burns.
Well, Murray, was Robert Burns a well-known name or poet in the United States during the mid-early 19th century? And how unusual would it have been for a person like Abraham Lincoln at that time to be aware of his work?
He's one of the very few writers of the late 18th century, the Romantic period in the British Isles, who has any real interest in the American Revolution. And Burns's strong association of the United States, emergent United States, and liberty is marked in at least five poems, and not all of which were published in his lifetime, because some of them were a little bit extreme. But the Americans, from the point of view of contemporary British politics, but the Americans appreciated them, and his poems were first published in the Pennsylvania Packet in 1788. The first St. Andrew's Night toast to Burns that we know happened in Pittsburgh in 1790, and from 1812 at least, there were regular Burns suppers in Baltimore. The association was always with America and liberty, but actually he was well enough known to be used in presidential elections. He was first used in an attack based on a caricature of Burns' poem on John Quincy Adams in the 1828 election, and Burns continued to be used right up to and including President Lincoln's election as president of the U.S. when John Anderson, My Joe, was used as Republican anthem, and there was a mock version of it created by the supporters of the Confederacy. So that Burns was absolutely, there were 24 editions of Burns's work published in the U.S. by 1860. Burns was absolutely central to American understanding of English language, broadly understood English language poetry in the 19th century. So I don't think it's at all surprising that an ambitious and intelligent young man like Lincoln was exposed to Burns, but probably through two routes, as I've suggested, probably through directly as in a literary route via Jack Kelso, but also through the fact that a lot of the songs circulating in the places where Lincoln was a boy were actually some of the songs that Burns had edited and developed in the Scots Musical Museum and other collections. And so his recognition of Burns came from different parts of his background, but Burns was so well known that he could be used straightforwardly in electoral politics by the end of the 1820s.
Well, ironically, it sounds like he may have been more popularly known at that time than he would be here today.
That, I think, is absolutely right. The United States was the first country to put up a statue to Burns. It is officially the steel statue in Central Park. But they appear to be statues of Burns' characters, who were almost as famous as the poet, in Baltimore as early as the 1830s. And characters from Tam O'Shanter were also recorded in a statue in Central Park before the steel statue. But interestingly enough, in Edinburgh was the first place to put up a statue to President Lincoln outside the United States. So let's say the feeling was mutual.
Ian, did President Lincoln's admiration for Burns extend to his wife, Mary Todd Lincoln?
Many of the songs and poetry of Burns were about love and love for other people. I believe that Lincoln would have used that poetry as he communicated with Mary. There are many characters in Burns's poetry. One is sort of a legendary character, and her name is Highland Mary. Now, Highland Mary, there's a bit of a legend associated with that particular story, but nevertheless, there are poems associated with Mary, multiple Marys in Burns's work. I believe that Lincoln would have cited that poetry in that verse as he connected with his own Mary. I have no doubt of that. We don't have confirmation because those were very intimate connections, but he would have used Burns in a way to court Mary. Mary herself was an avid reader. She herself became very acquainted with Burns through Lincoln. So it was a very close connection that they shared. It was a bond. I sort of envisioned them reading Burns together. I would say that it wasn't just Mary. I think the children of Mary and Abraham would have been very familiar with Burns. We had talked about Willie, and Willie, who died in the White House, of course, as a young boy, such a horrible, tragic loss for the Lincolns. But a reminder that Willie, we speak of him as Willie historically, his name was William Wallace. William Wallace Lincoln. He was named after Mary's brother-in-law. But I have no doubt that Lincoln himself would have reminded him of the great legend of William Wallace of Scotland. And that would have been quite inspirational to Willie as a young boy. So it was not just Mary, but the Lincoln family who knew of this passion that Lincoln had for Burns.
Well, Murray, it's reported that President Lincoln could recite Burns poems by heart. Can you share perhaps a few of his favorite verses or poems that Lincoln may have recited and that was known to recite at that time?
Well, one of the poems which he recited appears to be To a Mouse, which was certainly one he knew. Some people say he knew the whole of Burns by heart. I think we can take that with a pinch of salt. But he certainly knew Tam O'Shanter by heart, which is the set piece in so many Burns suppers today. And he was also very fond of To a Mouse, To a Louse, and Holy Willie's Prayer. I think those are all quite revealing because they're about humanity and hypocrisy and human passions and affections, and the limits of human virtue, as well as the good things about human virtue.
Well, before President Lincoln's life was tragically cut short in 1865, he and Mrs. Lincoln hoped to visit Scotland in their post-White House years. Ian, can you tell the story of this planned trip and what resulted after he was actually assassinated and he himself was not able to go?
They had planned to go to the UK and dreamt about going to London and Europe and these capitals, especially in Europe and, as I say, London, but had a real deep desire to go to Scotland. It's important, I think, for the audience to remember it wasn't just Burns who was the motivation. Burns became a vehicle for a deeper appreciation that Lincoln had for Scotland more broadly. He had an appreciation for other writers, Sir Walter Scott, a great poet named William Knox, who he also cited. So he became quite familiar with Scottish history, Scottish questions of the day, politics and culture. And so the two of them longed to go. They had this dream to go. And in fact, he said to one of his cabinet secretaries, John Hay, that after the Civil War was ended, that the sorrow and the depth and the grief that related to the Civil War that he shouldered so personally, he said to his secretary, "Now the Civil War, this great war is over. Let's finally plan this trip to Scotland so that I can go visit and pay tribute to Robert Burns," basically. So he was very mindful of the liberation that he was beginning to feel following the darkness of the Civil War. Scotland was very much on his mind because Burns in Scotland was always a release for him as a human being. I have no doubt that he read Burns during the dark times of the Civil War to liberate him from the challenges that were around him. And so in his mind, he and Mary wanted so desperately to travel to Scotland. So they had this plan. As you say, his life was taken, and they never had the opportunity to do that. What's poignant about the story is that Mary was so conscious of that and knew of this love that they shared for Scotland together, having never visited there, that they would still do the trip. She would go. She would take her youngest son with her, and she was there for a total time of 8 weeks and was very mindful of Lincoln throughout. She went to Alloway. She went to the cottage that we were talking about. She went to the markers, to Burns in Alloway, but also throughout Scotland. She visited what was very poignant. She visited there's a statue to Highland Mary in Greenock. And she visited that statue. She looked at it. And the story is she wept. To me, that was that they wanted to share that moment together. And again, to me, some confirmation that the Mary there was that Lincoln referred to his Mary. And Burns was talking about the Highland Mary and but they were connected there. It was poignant because while physically they were not together for that trip, I think spiritually they were together. And I think Mary Todd was very mindful of Lincoln during that entire trip. And so in that sense, he did make the trip because they were so aligned. as friends, as people who had this passion, both for Burns, but also for Scotland. I remind listeners that it was a passion that he had that reached well beyond just the individual of Robert Burns.
Well, that is really a magnificent, poignant, touching story, and the emotions that must have enveloped her and that had overcome her during that experience of visiting Scotland without him knowing what it would have meant to her husband to be there with her. So although he was never able to visit, there is a statue in Edinburgh in Old Calton Cemetery, and I was actually able to visit there recently and see this statue. It's quite remarkable. In fact, I spoke with several Scots friends who did not know it was there. Several prominent Americans in Edinburgh didn't know it was there. And so I went on the afternoon of Christmas Day and went in and saw it, and it was really very special. Mm-hmm. Tell us how that statue came to be there.
You had individuals from Scotland and Edinburgh who were serving in the Civil War, in the American Civil War, who perished during the American Civil War. And so later on, one of the widows of one of the lads who was killed in the Civil War really was quite adamant that there should be some sort of monument to the Civil War that honored those individuals who had been killed, who had fought during the Civil War but were Scottish. So she was successful in raising the profile of that effort. The statue was produced here in the United States, and it was shipped over. And it's the only presidential statue in Scotland that exists.
And it's been there for 130 so years.
1890s.
Remains the only yes. American president represented by statue, and I believe was the first American president to have a statue in the whole of Europe.
That's correct.
Which
first.
Is remarkable
That's
as well.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, quite a story and yep. wonderful to see. And I encourage everyone to visit yeah, Scotland, as you
absolutely.
Recommended. It's really a very special place. Well, Murray Burns Night, of course, is still celebrated every year in Scotland and around the world. In fact, this episode will be released on that very special day this year. Tell us how Robert Burns is remembered in modern day Scotland, and what are some of the current traditions that honor and celebrate his legacy there?
Burns is obviously, he's very much a Scottish figure and very much a global figure. We think that around about 9.5 million people go to official Burns suppers worldwide every year. And but Scotland will always remain the epicenter. And the traditional format, of course, is the toast to the haggis, the supper, the immortal memory, the toast to the lasses in reply, and usually a recital, typically of Tam O'Shanter. But the number of people who know Tam O'Shanter by heart in this social media and digital age is getting more and more limited. So often another poem is substituted. I think one of the traditions which endures in Scotland, though it can get a bit wearing, is the Cayley tradition, whereby everybody who is at the supper, who feels like it, then volunteers to do a party piece related to Burns. And as the evening wears on, these may not be particularly entertaining, should we put it, as people lose their ability to actually deliver them at the best level. But fundamentally, people sometimes get hung up about the formality of the Burns Supper, and it isn't a formal occasion. The only thing you ultimately need is an immortal memory, and it's really important to keep having them, because as I pointed out by the Scottish government study on Burns, the Scottish economy 2 years ago, actually the Scottish haggis industry depends on Burns Night. So much of its sales are actually linked directly or indirectly to Burns Night. And indeed, we owe the vegetarian haggis to a last minute effort by the Scots company McSween's to satisfy an international gathering about 50 years ago, which contained the then unheard of concept in Scotland, a number of vegetarians. So in other words, Scotland has innovated on the sustainable haggis front as well as the as well as the meat-based one.
Well, Robert Burns isn't the only Scottish person with a deep connection to the White House. In fact, the Scottish influence extends back to the laying of the cornerstone in 1792, and the Scottish stonemasons that we've talked about and on this podcast and written about, and they contributed to the construction of the White House. And then there's also the 34 presidents themselves that claim to be of Scottish descent. Murray, what does this mean to the people of Scotland? Is it well known? Do they feel this historic connectivity with our country that we are talking about here today?
Scots are not quite so aware of the importance and of their own diaspora as they might be. There was research done in the 1990s which suggested that whereas Irish Americans and indeed Irish Canadians tended to think that they had been driven off the land and cleared, even if their ancestors had left for economic reasons which were voluntary. On the other hand, descendants of Scottish emigrants tended to think that they had left voluntarily, even if you could document that their ancestors had been cleared off the land. It's very interesting, something going on there, very interesting opposition going on there, and it tends to make the link less marked. In Scotland, we don't fully appreciate that, and there is a conversation, which I hope the event we're discussing in April will forward, a conversation to be had to move that on. So actually, the answer is we don't know as much as we should, and we're not as much in contact as we would like. And there's a great opportunity there on both sides, and I look forward to taking advantage of it.
Well, I look forward to sharing this podcast with as many friends in Scotland as we can connect with, and look forward to both of you helping us with that as well. But Murray, you mentioned giving toast as a portion of the Burns Night celebrations. And seeing as this episode will be released on January 25th, Burns Night, I'm going to put you both here to the test a little bit and ask you to give your best immortal memory toast to end this wonderful conversation that we've had today. So, Murray, I'll call on you first.
Well, my immortal memories are succinct, but they usually take 15 minutes. One of the things that they do embody always is Burns, the poet of feelings and relationships. So what I would say is I will give this immortal memory toast in on the lips of President Lincoln himself, who just a few days before he was shot said to his secretary, John Hay, "Burns never touched sentiment without carrying it to its ultimate expression and leaving nothing further to be said." And I couldn't agree more. That is the immortal memory of Robert Burns.
Wow. Thank you so much. And Ian?
I will have a memory of this moment, just spending time with the two of you. It's quite a remarkable experience. Again, thank you to the White House Historical Association for what you do in preserving history and memories of people before us. Old friends not to be forgotten. I think it's very important in the situation that we're all facing that we remember the importance of friends. Auld Lang Syne as a song and a poem is used for New Year's. We hug, we embrace, we talk about the new year ahead of us. As well it should be. We ring in the new year, we sing the song. But it was written as a reflection. He wrote the reflection on posing the question, should we forget old friends? That's how he starts the piece. And of course, an affirmative no, we should always remember the friends that we have experienced over the last year. So as we think of a toast and a memory and a tribute to Burns, we need to remember those who we've had experience, the friends in our lives, the family members in our lives, this last year as we go forward to next year. I wish everyone good health and good fortune. Wish you well as we continue to bridge these connections between Scotland and the United States as human beings, as people, and just a cup of kindness. I think Lincoln himself was such a charitable man at heart. His great second inaugural address, which spoke of charity, he pulled that from Burns. Mm-hmm. So let's just be charitable and good towards one another. So reflect on the experience we've had last year, go forward with confidence and build positive things together is my toast. So
and
cheers.
Wonderful.
Everyone.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Well, my immortal memory goes both past and present to my ancestors who came from Scotland 10 generations ago as the indentured servants to another clan. It took them two generations to be deeded them their freedom and a small plot of land in down eastern North Carolina. And they never knew that generations later, someone that was descended from them would have any idea about them or their circumstance or their story, or that would be working to tell these stories of the White House and its history, and a president and someone that they would likely have been aware of with Robert Burns. And a very special connection for me. And then also to today, my wonderful friends in Scotland and those that I have the opportunity to both be friends with and work with to tell these stories. We put up the plaque on Queen Street,
yes.
Went to see the Lincoln statue, and we hope to be honoring that on Lincoln's birthday every year. And to have these conversations and the friendship with the two of you, and thank you for all you do to help us tell these stories as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Murray, very much for being with us.
I wish I could be there in person. We would have a convivial day.
Well, we'll see you soon here. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Murray and Ian, for providing such wonderful insights on the significant influence that Robert Burns had on America's 16th president, Abraham Lincoln. On behalf of the White House Historical Association, I also want to thank all of our listeners and viewers of the 1600 Sessions podcast for your dedicated support of our mission. I really enjoy sharing interesting and often untold stories of the White House and its history through these conversations that we have the opportunity and the privilege of sharing in each episode. As you all know, the Association is a nonprofit organization, nonpartisan. We take no money from the federal government whatsoever, and we rely on the support and generosity of individuals such as you. If you'd like to contribute to the preservation of the history and support the work of the White House Historical Association, or if you'd like to learn more about these incredible stories of the White House and its history, visit our website at whitehousehistory.org. Thank you very much, and we look forward to seeing you on the next episode of the 1600 Sessions.